What is health? What does it mean to be healthy? These are questions that have troubled humanity ever since the dawn of language. This wrap is a collaborative inquiry report into the subjectivity of health and well-being. It is an urgent call to step back and question the current model of health and make room for other interpretations, an invitation to remain vigilant, skeptical, and reflexive. In the words of Friedrich Nietzsche, there are no facts, only interpretations. Truth, health, and science are subjective and fluid. It is from this epistemological perspective that this report is situated.
Subjectivity, avoiding reflexivity. The current medical model is enabling naivety. Can't you see the focus is on enabling illness? Keep the people sick, keep money flowing to the business. Follow the money and you'll see pharmaceutical companies funding universities. They spend twice as much on marketing than they do on research and developing.
But tell me why we still ignore the sneaky corporate ego when we force a project effects duplicated by placebo. Let me tell you a story of a modern medicine. It begins with Democritus, man is materialism. Atom, space, and ocean, that's all that there is. But what about the invisible boom vitalism? Set up out Socrates, there's a spirit within. This vital force energy should be acknowledged in medicine. So for a while, people danced with Socrates' notions. Then Newton came along with his three laws of motion. So celestial mechanics, calculus, and thermodynamics dictated medicine, measurable mechanical semantics. What complicated things was a man named Descartes? Was a noble, he had managed to rip the human apart. You may remember when he said, I think therefore I am. Cartesian dualism was in full demand. At that point, the mission of science, stated by Francis Bacon, was to obtain knowledge to control or dominate nature. Yeah. Uh-oh. You see a theme here? We're not done.
Along came a fellow by the name of Darwin. He concluded our traits are of hereditary origin. And Watson and Crick in 1953 introduced a central dogma governing you and me. The junction that we so fervently obey states that our structure and our fate are determined by our DNA.
Why is this a problem, you ask? Well, the very idea of genetic determinism makes us victims of our heredity, essentially rendering us powerless and vulnerable, looking to something outside of us for help. Medication, pills, and vaccines have become our 21st century gods. But how did this come to be?
You might remember a dude called John D. Rockefeller. Late 1800s, he was America's largest oil seller. Standard Oil became a $1 trillion empire, and still he found ways to get his profits even higher. What's that? Scientists have discovered that the byproducts of oil can be made into pharmaceutical drugs? I'm sure you can guess what happened next. This cheeky rubber baron became a philanthropist, sending millions of dollars to hospitals and colleges, and opening powerful front groups that promoted the use of these petrochemical drugs. Holistic doctors and medicines were sneakily demonized, and in a short time, over half of all medical colleges in the U.S. were closed. Medical education became homogenized, and America was hypnotized by this pill-for-the-pill mentality. So that's one narrative of modern medicine's history, but the definition of health is still quite a mystery. Here in the West, we treat the symptoms not that really. It's the quest for a cure is an unprofitable pursuit. But what about other cultures, other histories, and narratives? So what do they say about well-being's imperative?
Well, I have a friend in the cloud who walks the red road,
acknowledging the unity of body, mind, soul. This perspective ain't unique to him. It's the backbone of the ancient ones and a mystic interpretation passed down from Mellor's daughters and sons. Said by Joseph Masti and Elder of the Cree, if the land is not healthy, then how can we be? Now let's look at some women of the 16th century, stigmatized, burned alive in the name of Christianity. These little old women, they say, are working for the devil, gonna set her on fire for making tea out of nettle. It's a matter of power and control, ultimately, all the genocidal Christians and their fragile masculinity. These women were herbalists, healers, revealers, so much wisdom wiped away by some ruthless dogma dealers. What's left are the whispers, memories that were resistors, rediscovering the knowledge of our ancient witch sisters.
Now let's take a trip to the east, where they've known for so long that we are never separate. To the earth we belong from duality. Ayurveda departs, understanding the whole is greater than some of its parts.
Chinese medicine too consists of five elements: fire, earth, water, metal, and one of the body's intelligence. The foundation of Taoism, the yin and the yang, call forth harmony with nature as that's literally the way. Now before we move on, let's acknowledge the polarity, the absolute irony of helping humanity. Take the sacred Ganges set to purify the spirit, but really with the pollution, we should probably stay clear of it. This is just one paradox of many that show that health is subjective to perspective, we just really don't know. So here in the West, we felt disconnected from nature. All these glass and mitochondria jungles were a deal breaker. So what do? We escape back to our roots, enacting capitalist self-actualizing eco pursuits. Armed with evidence saying nature is healthy, we create a new outlet for the privileged and wealthy. Before spathing ecotherapy, adventure before psych, our daily life and problems, are these just a fleeting escape? Savannah biophilia hypothesis blame, it's in our nature to love nature with critical acclaim. Written in our genes is a hereditary code, demonstrating the healing power that nature's bestowed. Attentively restorative with frustrated boosting attributes, nature's been prescribed as an effective disease antidote. But while there's endless evidence in favor of reconnecting, why is it still that so many find nature in effect? Maybe nature's power is less about healing properties and more about perspective and our individual histories. Nature versus nurture, perhaps a bit of both. Will we ever really know the root of our growth? If you're looking for a certain answer, you'll find it. Research is often born out of a desire to prove bias. That's why when we unpick the diverse evidence body, it's filled to the brim with contradicting dichotomy. So you're probably confused at this point. What is health? What is truth? These questions extend far outside the scope of environmental health and well-being. But let's stay focused. I will now move on to finally discuss a particular environment in detail. Controversially, I believe this environment to be the most important and of highest priority. This is the environment of the human body. So medicine believes our body mind is a machine, victims of heredity governed by our genes. But what if I told you we have more power than we think, that we are the creators of our own environment? Epigenetics tell them victim mentality, proving that we create our biological reality. Let me summarize the empowering evidence as briefly as possible, but nothing makes some sense. You take a group of stencils and divide by three. Place each group in a dish petri. Each cell is identical, but in each dish is a culture medium that's slightly different. After a while, we say, what's that? The cells have turned into bone, muscle, and fat. That's right. Stem cells provide a simple representation of how an environment creates cell behavior. So what does this look like in our bodily environment of 40 trillion cells? Well, we are essentially skin-covered petri dishes, and the blood is the culture medium of our cells. The chemistry of our blood is what controls the behavior of our cells. And what controls the chemistry of our blood? Two things, nutrition and our brain. Our thoughts, emotions, and perceptions create complementary chemistry in our blood. These chemical signals, either stress or growth hormones, determine which cell receptors will be activated, in turn creating specific cell behavior and gene expression or suppression. In short, perception warrants direct impacts on our biology. These new discoveries have had huge implications on the way we look at disease and health. The evidence continues to highlight our personal power and agency regarding all aspects of our health, which, by the way, is in a profitable perspective of customers of the medical industry to realize. So, what am I saying here? I'm saying that there's only two environments, within and the without. What separates them is perception, no doubt. If a tree falls in the forest and there's no one around to hear it, is its action dependent on those who perceive? External stimuli and experiences are differently interpreted through individual lenses. The environment is chilling, it's just doing a thing. Its health is dependent on interpretation. Forgiving and resenting persist and unbiased. The grass continues growing in the cracks and the silos. Ultimately, it's up to us to determine and define
what is health, what is truth, what is what, how and why.
But each of our perceptions have been shaped by our experience. Our trauma, pain, love, and life become an attempt to make some sense. Why do you think humans disagree on virtually every topic under the sun? We all need food, water, shelter, and we all want to feel good. The only thing separating us from each other is perception, which is shaped by our past conditioning and our future worries. As we've learned, our beliefs about the world can create our biology. Stress hormones shut down immune functions, leading to disease and unwanted gene expression, while growth hormones promote growth. Gellert in 2008 found that black women in disadvantaged social environments have much higher rates of breast cancer than women in more advantaged environments due to their exhausted cortisol measure. But my provocative yet empowering question is this: what creates the cortisol stress hormone? The environment or the perception of the environment? Change your mindset, change your life. We are not victims of our circumstances. And yes, I fully acknowledge the epistemological access issues to changing mindset. Many people are in indeed very rough situations that make it harder to shift belief systems. However, I've seen this inaccessibility confronted, challenged, and dismantled in effective ways. My family friend works with inner city schools in Minneapolis, empowering kids to let go of their labels, their conditioning, and step into their personal creative power on this earth. So now that we've covered how our perceptions of the world influence our internal environment, how does our internal environment influence the outside environment and the people around us?
Each nerve in our body has a magnetic field like an electrical wire. Its activities reveal this activity extends far beyond our anatomy. Magnetical encephalographs pick up on the strategy.
Take a look at this contraption and then tell me, is it touching them? What do you believe? It's not our brain activity, it's this outside our head. Our thoughts and our perceptions extend, so they said. That's why the physicists, the scientists of energies, instead of doctors or biologists, make medical machines. The pinpoint disease and MEDs in MRIs literally look for the funky vibes.
The hippies were right.
They shouted, shocked. For so long it was them that they had mocked. Now to take this even further, blow your mind a bit more. The Einstein Podolsky was a paradox we'll explore. In this study together, two people meditated, developing phase coherence. Their brain was correlated. In the state the two were separated, 50 feet between them, but quantumly integral. Strobe light was flashed in only one man's face. What happened next? Quantum physics or divine grace? Both dudes' brain waves showed evoked potential of fast firing, absolutely not accidental. This incredibly comprehensive study suggests the energetic entanglement between human beings, while still not entirely understood or accepted as the status quo. Studies like these provide food for thought in pondering interhuman environmental health, connection on a deeper quantum mechanical level. So there we have it, a collaborative inquiry report into the subjectivity of health. A lot of heavy material was covered. In the last bit, we explored the human body as an environment and showcased some confronting new science in the study of human health, highlighting the power of the mind to create and manage one's internal and external environment. This report is an invitation to step back and open your mind to this new quantum leap in defining truth, science, and health.